Hello and welcome to another episode of the PRFC Fan Show, a fan show by fans for fans. I'm Kevin.
And I'm Dan. And you know what? I like defacing property.
Oh, Dan, what is this thing you have done?
Gross, isn't it?
I can fix this.
No, you can't
easily
fix it.
Easily fixed.
You can't fix a sticker.
Fixed.
Oh, you can just stick over them?
Yeah, I'm teaching people stuff all the time, Dan.
Who'd have thought?
It's a miracle. You know, Dan, the New Mexico game was the only game this season that I really wanted to be at, and I couldn't go because of work. It really was harsh, but I saw everything going on, and I was so jealous.
It was incredible. What a trip. We had the time of our lives before, during, and after. How about we do a little montage?
Sounds great.
It's over. It's over.
Dan, that was a night to remember. I am so glad you were able to be there for it, man.
It was a night to remember. I remember most of it.
Yeah, I bet. Kudos to Phoenix Rising for letting, and I guess really Solo, for letting everybody into the locker room and for putting up with the fans. I mean, outstanding. I've never seen anything like that before in my life.
That was some mighty fine singing and dancing.
It was. And, you know, we had a lot to celebrate because we really did not perform that well in the first half and well into the second half of that game.
They were looking a little bit sluggish.
A little bit sluggish. They just seemed disconnected. The midfield wasn't connecting with the forwards. The team just didn't seem to have the intensity that New Mexico had. And, you know, Dan, sometimes I wonder if that reflects on the speech that maybe Coach Shantz gives in the locker room before the game. What do you think?
You know, usually we only hear about mid-game speeches and post-game speeches, but I think, maybe it has something to do with a little bit of pre-game.
You think it might have looked something like this?
Great moments are born from great opportunity. And that's what you have here tonight, boys.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's totally what it looked like.
I don't know, man. I will say this, though. You know what? We came into the second half. We were lackadaisical, but all of a sudden things started to kick in. And, you know, I really feel like that was a reaction to what Rick Shawn said to the team in the locker room during halftime. And I have a feeling that the speech probably went something like this.
He's going to laugh at you. No, they're all going to laugh at you.
Look, it's
not too late. You can stay here with me.
Holy cow. Wow, yeah. If Rick started coming at me with that, it would definitely light a fire under my ass.
Well, it certainly lit a fire under our team. We were still a little flat for the 15 minutes starting in the second half. New Mexico scored a goal pretty quick in the second half. Mm-hmm. But when the chips were down, our intensity level went up 100,000%.
This team, they go to 11.
Oh, and if you don't know that reference, go check out your rock and roll movies, because that's a must-have, don't you think?
Absolutely.
Yep. Anyways, we upped the intensity. We went to 11. We got the two goals that we needed. We got the point. We locked regular season champions. Dude, we did everything we needed to do in that night.
Everything and a little bit more.
Wait, wait, wait. Get that crossfade out of here. We got more to talk about.
We do. We have the New Mexico game to talk about.
We've got the New Mexico game to talk about.
What a great night. The footy on the field is intense. The stadium, equally intense between the SGs and the New Mexico fans. It was a great night, capped off with the fans being in the locker room with the team and celebrating not only the draw, but that we won the regular season championship.
Yep.
A great night.
Incredible experience. I wouldn't have missed it for the world.
I'm glad you were there, and I was so jealous that I couldn't be there. But that being said, we do notice on Twitter a little bit that the New Mexico fans seem to be a little butthurt and just, oh, they have issues. And so we wanted to come onto the show and tell them all that we are truly, from the bottom of our hearts, sorry.
We're sorry. We're sorry that when a couple fans tried to rip down those Banditos banner and get us tossed out of the stadium, it didn't work.
We're so sorry that your crowd feels like they need to ooh and ah in the stadium during the game, like your Johnny soccer game at 7 a.m. on a Saturday morning.
We're just sorry that those two drummers that made their way up near us to try and throw us off beat were unsuccessful.
We are so sorry that we're so hard-edged and intense, and that we didn't show up with orange slices to share with everyone and sing Kumbaya with.
And we're sorry, although they were unsubstantiated, for those claims of magnet theft and stickers on personal property.
And most of all, we're really sorry that you had a decent start to the season, and congratulations for that start. You're a new club. But we're really sorry that right now you're in 11th place and have pretty much a very, very slim chance of even making it to the playoffs, and will probably end up in 13th or 14th place.
So, I think that pretty well covers the New Mexico game. What's next?
I think that's it, too. Well, of course, we're going to follow that up with a guy who silenced all their fans, Mr. Joey Calistri.
Joey Cash Money Calistri.
I talked to Joey for a while. We had a great conversation. Dan there was there for it also. Why don't we check it out?
Let's do it.
I'm here with Joey Calistri. Joey, it is a pleasure to have you on the show. Thank you so much for coming.
Of course, yeah. Thanks for having me. The pleasure's all mine.
Well, you know, right now you're kind of in the god status in the world of soccer fandom here in Phoenix, as you well know. We're going to get to all that later, so we really appreciate it. It's funny because we always do a little poll. I mean, if I could interview every player, I would, but that's just not possible. So we do go to the fans and ask fans, you know, who do you want to see? And, of course, people were, like, DMing me and stuff saying after the game, they're like, you have to talk to Joey. Just talk to Joey. And I was like, okay, sorry, Vaquero.
Maybe next time. No, I'm glad we're doing this. It's great.
Well, appreciate it. I always go through a little bit of your career and how you got into soccer. I thought it was cool that you're an Illinois boy. I think Illinois is actually one of the cooler states in the union.
Appreciate that, yeah.
And where you grew up, I think it was Deerfield?
Yeah.
Yeah? So I used to go to Chicago all the time for work. Yeah. Down in, what's it called? I can't think of the name. Not Beaver Creek. Buffalo Grove.
Oh, Buffalo Grove. Yeah. My brother lives there, actually.
Oh, does he?
Yeah. Yeah.
And that whole area, you have North something, where Ferris Bueller was filmed and all that stuff.
Yeah. Oh, great movies, yeah. Breakfast Club was filmed over there, too. Yeah.
There you go. Yeah. So Chicago's a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah.
You were born the same year my first kid was born, so that puts age into perspective.
That's a good one.
How did you like growing up in Chicago?
I loved it. Yeah, it was awesome. I mean, we were out in the burbs, but it was a really cool community. I think a lot of my best friends that I still talk to every day are from Deerfield, and you know, we have a close group of guys that are, you know, playing fantasy football and hanging out all the time in off season. So it was awesome.
That's great. Yeah. Now you went up through the Chicago Fire Academy and I think their professional development system, correct?
Yeah.
Can you tell me a little bit about that? Because development, as you know, has been a big story for the USL lately.
Yeah, so I played, actually, so I mostly I started with like a local club. It was from Buffalo Grove, actually, called Schwaben, like a German club. And I played there until I was about probably like 14. Mm-hmm. And then I moved from there to the Fire Juniors. And then basically for like my last year and a half of high school, I played with the academy. And even when I was with the, it's kind of funny that, you know, all the nicknames are coming up because my senior year for academy, I was, you know, the guy coming off the bench and the super sub kind of guy where I think I was, you know, I was up there in terms of goals in the development academy near the top in the country, but I wasn't starting most games. So that's kind of a role that I've had before and I enjoyed it. But I think the Fire Academy is really big for development just because anytime you get the best players in a big geographic area into one place playing with each other, it's always good for development.
Well, it is. And key for the USL, I'm a big proponent for the USL surpassing the MLS. I love watching MLS games and everything, but I really think the organization itself is flawed and they're not really about the fans. And I feel like what Jake Edwards has going on with the USL is much more fan-oriented.
Yeah.
So from my perspective, it's a lot more important. So I like to see it. Do you see yourself someday participating as a coach or an instructor for any kind of a development program?
Yeah, I'm sure. I mean, absolutely down the line at some point, I think it's something I'd want to do. You know, I haven't thought too much about it, haven't really worked on getting licenses yet, but I think down the line, you know, as once I'm done playing, you know,
when you're old, like
20, 25 years from now, when I'm done playing, you know, I'd like to, I'd probably get into, you know, coaching in some capacity.
It's so fun. I mean,
yeah.
I've coached a couple of teams,
exactly,
young
kids
and stuff, and it gets frustrating, but it's still fun.
Yeah, oh, it's worth it, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, you went to Northwestern.
Yep.
Couldn't find what you majored in when you were at Northwestern.
So I studied communications.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Did you enjoy it?
I did, yeah. So I was, funny story, I actually interned for the Chicago Fire Communication Department before I signed with them.
Okay.
So I think I was the first intern to sign for the first team.
Wow.
Yeah.
So deep history there with them.
Yeah,
so are
exactly.
You a Chicago Fire fan?
Yeah. Yeah, I am. Yeah. It's good to see them. It's good to see them doing well now, moving back into the city. I think that'd be good for them.
So you think Soldier Field is a good move for them?
I think it's the right move for now. I think it's tough to get fans out to Bridgeview. You know, it was an interesting environment we played. Obviously, it was still very fun, but but I think just being in Chicago, you know, obviously it's a huge stadium. They might not fill it out at first or anything, but
probably not.
but I think it's the right move. I think getting back in the city is a big deal for them.
Well, I think getting in the city is a big deal,
yeah.
And the city is so crowded, you
exactly.
can't build another stadium.
Exactly. It's tough, yeah.
I get it. Who's your favorite player playing for Chicago Fire right now, would you say?
I'd probably go with my guy, Dax. Absolutely great leader, great professional, awesome guy off the field, you know, really approachable. I definitely learned a lot from him.
Okay. The correct answer was Schweinsteiger.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's another one, of course, obviously. But.
I'm a big Bundesliga guy. So
oh, okay, okay.
And
yeah.
Bayern Munich's my,
yeah.
them and Berlin are my teams.
Okay, yeah.
I need to go watch him play. I've never seen
it's,
him on the pitch.
Awesome. Yeah. I mean, you could even in training, you could tell just he's got that another level of class that, you know, is really rare.
He's amazing. And
yeah.
he never gets sick. He's always on the pitch, except
always.
When I would go see games.
Really?
Yeah. And then he was not. And it was, yeah, that's,
poor
I'm
timing.
Not bitter. You played a bit for the Tulsa Roughnecks.
Yeah.
How did you like playing for Tulsa?
It was fun. You know, I think, you know, from being on loan with Chicago, you know, obviously when you're on an MLS team and you go on loan at first, you want to be playing with the MLS and you want to be playing with your parent club. But
sure.
once I embraced it and, you know, me and Colin Fernandez were both there rooming together and we had a great group of guys there, you know, it was a lot of fun. We had a talented group. So we enjoyed it. Yeah, it was cool. You know, it was cool bringing that, you know, because – there was a lot of buzz around the team because we were doing well and they hadn't really done well before, so it was fun to be a part of that.
I think it would be difficult to make that transition MLS to USL, especially in the past. I think maybe today it's getting a little bit easier because, for lack of a better term, the respect for the USL is starting to grow a little bit. So you see the people like Tristan Blackwood or someone like that, you know, not having that much of a problem going down and being a loanee for a while.
Yeah.
It seems to me that the play that Chicago Fire played and what Tulsa played are very different styles.
Yeah.
Did you play the same position when you went to Tulsa?
Yeah, for the most part. I mean, I've, as you can tell, I've played, you know, plenty of positions in my time. But But I like to think I'm pretty adaptable. But I, for the most part, I was playing as a winger in Tulsa and as a winger for Chicago.
Oh, were you? Okay, I thought you were a midfielder for Chicago.
Yeah, so I played right back for Chicago as a 10, as a winger. So I played a couple spots there.
Wow, that's diverse.
Yeah.
We're actually going to talk about your diversity in a little bit. After Tulsa came St. Louis, right?
Yep.
The one thing they have, well, they have a footy team, I guess, currently.
They do.
And an arch.
Yep, they do. They have
and
an
a lot
arch.
Of danger,
they
apparently.
They have a big arch and a little bit of danger in the city, yeah. But it's a fun place, that, aside from the danger.
Did you enjoy your time with the team? Because I do make fun of St. Louis a lot, but I do have a huge respect for the team.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, the Luligans are pretty crazy. Like, I've been pretty fortunate to play for teams that have, like incredible fan bases.
Yeah, sure.
Obviously, different levels in terms of, you know, how many fans they get out and stuff like that, but... you know, playing in St. Louis was a lot of fun. And we again, had a good group, and we were really determined to, you know, obviously our goal was making the playoffs because they hadn't done that before. So to be able to do that with Tulsa and then St. Louis was pretty cool.
Yeah, that's a lot of fun. So we have a little consistency between these teams
starting to
win.
Exactly.
Then you bring it to Phoenix.
Yeah.
Now, I did think it was interesting. I had to write this down because old age, I forget. You were in St. Louis from, like, January of 2018 till December when you joined Phoenix.
Yeah.
And in that short time, you had 5 goals and 2 assists.
Yeah.
That's enough. You know, you keep this ratio going of the goals and the assists. I mean, that's the sign of a well-rounded player, I think, somebody who's not selfish. Do you feel like when you're on the field that, and this is a weird question, but I see this in players, do you feel like you're willing to give the ball up anytime you need to for someone else to get the more sure score?
Yeah, no, I think that's just, you know, how I've been as a player. I think, you know, I'm always a team-first kind of guy, so whatever the team needs me to do, if that's putting a shift defensively and you know, maybe take a little away offensively or come in and try to score some goals, whatever the team needs in that situation, you know, that's what I try to do.
Adaptable. And I like that because you do see, not with Phoenix Rising, because I think we're probably the most unselfish team in the United States. But you do see it in other leagues where there's a lot of selfish play to the detriment of the team, right?
Exactly.
Your adaptation between positions is amazing. You know, sometimes we see you in the midfield, sometimes we see you on the wing, right? Coach Sean seems to know when to put you in and where, and the dynamic between you and Solo is kind of interesting because, for instance, and I'm stealing this from Joe and Cleet, so sorry, Joe, because... I saw it, but I didn't recognize it like he does because he's amazing. Asante, he needed you on that wing, and he needed to bring Asante in to confuse him in the middle when we were playing New Mexico because they were sitting so deep in the field. Paid off in spades.
Yeah.
How comfortable were you playing on the wing against those opponents? Because you really looked like you had confidence going against those guys.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean... that's the good thing about my career is I've played, you know, in my fourth professional year, I've played all over the field. So I have experience playing in different spots, different situations, different game situations. So pretty much I like to think I'm pretty comfortable no matter what the situation is and where I am on the field.
Not all players can do that. You know, that's it's a talent. There are some players who are like, I play on the left side of the field, I play left wing. Leave me there. You know, I know some very, very big names who have huge FIFA ratings, by the way, that can't do it, right? Joan Cleats did follow up, and I'm half blind here, so I have to look at this. Where are you, Joe? Here we go. Actually, we covered it all. How are you positionally able to be so flexible, and you play out wide and central on both spots so well? What's the biggest difference for you? I mean, it's kind of interesting because on the USL site, it shows that you're forward on the PRC roster. It shows that you're midfielder.
Yeah, exactly. It is pretty fun when that like pops up during games and it says like forward or mid. Yes, you know, it always gets like, I guess, yeah, sure.
What do you consider yourself to be?
I would say midfielder because that's more of a broad range, I guess. You know, I'm not really a nine. I used to play nine in college, but I'd say probably just an attacking midfielder.
Okay, that's fair.
I guess that's what we can go with.
Yeah, well, I mean, well, you're not a box-to-box guy like Lambert.
Yeah.
You know, you can keep it out on the wing and have the right kind of play. You obviously have the skills to be able to bring the ball in.
Yeah.
When you play as a midfielder and you're at practice, where are you focusing? Like, when you're at practice, what are you saying to yourself, okay, this is where I really need to be working right now?
Yeah, so, I mean, center mid is a little new to me. I play there a little bit, but you know, I think when I get reps there in practice, I'm focusing a lot on my positioning and areas where I can find the ball in between lines so I could turn and try to create some attacking chances.
Okay. Do you feel like the speed of play which we play at makes it more challenging for you?
I think it makes it more enjoyable, actually.
Oh, really?
I think a lot of times when you have a team that just kind of moves the ball slowly and, you know, isn't really...
Barcelona!
Nobody heard that. No. But no, I think the fact that we move the ball quick and we try to get up the field and we attack with numbers, I think it makes it more enjoyable because there's more fluidity and there's more movement and more creativity. So I kind of like that environment.
If you had one skill that you could be the king of in the world, what would that skill be?
Soccer related.
Yep.
Man, I don't know. Let's see.
He's going to say scoring skill. Against Lubin.
I mean, I already have that one down, so it's all right. Yeah.
Oh!
Check the practice tape. I'm kidding. I don't know. I mean, I just, you know, obviously finishing would be the most important skill, I think, you know. Being able to finish in the box,
yeah. Yeah. Or in this case, with you lately, outside of the box.
Or outside, yeah, exactly, yeah. I don't score too many from outside the box, but I guess it's a new trend.
You have one officially outside of the box, but it was one heck of an outside of the box
exactly.
Shot, right? For me, I played midfielder back in 1822, and what I really wanted to perfect was the long pass.
Yeah, okay.
For me, and that's because I'm not a winner, and I wasn't thinking in terms of finishing, so.
Hey, that leads to chances, so it works too.
It does. Yeah. It's just fun, but the game is so different today than it was back then.
Yeah.
It
in
would
1822.
Apply. Yeah. The ball was made out of sheep ladders. It wasn't
wearing
even
wearing 50-pound cleats. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It was rocks. Yeah. They weren't cleats. They were rocks in the bottom. So who have you bonded with on the team, on the pitch?
In terms of playing, I think, you know, me and Solo have a good dynamic out there. Me and Adam can combine well as well. You know, Jose, I think, like, for the most part, all of the attacking players have kind of connected pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's just kind of a group of us that know where we're going to be now and know what kind of player we are. So I think for the most part, we've all gelled really well.
When it comes to communication, what would you say is different today than from what we had at the beginning of the season?
It's like I said, it's just easier to communicate when you know what guys are going to do. You have an idea what they're going to do.
So obviously, you get the anticipation.
Exactly, yeah. So the beginning of the year, we had, you know, some new guys in and obviously a good group of guys back from last year. But just now that we're nearing the end of the season, getting to the fun part, it's easier to communicate knowing what guys are capable of, what they want to do.
When you're tracking down the side of the field and you're glancing over your shoulder to see what's going on, is there anybody specific you're looking for, or are you just looking for a red shirt that's in an open space?
Yeah, I mean, obviously anytime you can get Solo the ball in a dangerous spot, that's what you want to do. Obviously him and Junior are both very dynamic out wide, so I think when we can isolate those guys and have them taken on outside backs, you know, good things are going to happen.
Okay, that's fair. The beauty of this team, again, is the depth. I mean, we just have great depth. And also the friendly dynamic. I always watch subs very closely because I want to see how the subs are reacting. Yeah. We get it when a guy's having a bad game. He's coming off the field and he's full of piss and vinegar.
Yeah.
But like when Aguinaga came off for you in the New Mexico game, he was just happy to see you get on the field. I don't think you want to leave the pitch,
exactly,
right?
Yeah, you never do, yeah.
But
yeah.
He was glad that he was handing the keys over to you, so to speak.
Yeah.
You don't always see that.
No, definitely not. I think that speaks to the character of the team and what we try to be about, the values that we're building. You know, obviously you always want to be on the field. We all do. That's just part of being a player. But, you know, we understand the depth we have and we understand the players at any point that we have on the bench, you know. So if it's either night or day or there's a tactical change that we need to make, we understand that, you know, it's just part of the game and, you know, it's going to help us try to win.
Has Rick Shantz toughened you guys up?
I think so, yeah. You know, I think we've all had patches this year that were maybe tough individually, which is just part of being, you know, a professional soccer player. You know, you go through phases where maybe you're out of favor, maybe it's not going your way. And that just, you know, that just makes it, you know, all the better when it is going your way. And it just makes you want to get back out there.
He is not afraid to make the tough calls, you know, and he seems like the nicest guy. You could go borrow his lawnmower or something like that. I mean, I'm not saying that he's not, but at the same time, he's hard as nails.
Yeah.
I mean, it's crazy.
Yeah.
And I think it gets reflected in games like New Mexico, where we kind of start off slow, and then we get tougher as the game goes on.
Yeah.
It's one of my favorite things about Bayern Munich. They're more dangerous, you know, at the end of the game than they are at the beginning. It seems like he has kind of instilled that into the team, not giving up, tenacity, fitness, and being able to handle it. If you could talk to Rick right now and say, Rick, I want this to happen for the rest of the season. Is there anything you'd ask him for? Like anything, like days off. I want to be able to eat a steak or whatever it might be.
No, I mean, I think the setup we have here, the staff, everybody, Rick and the rest of the coaching staff, training staff, have done a good job of getting us prepared for games. And you know, we have a game plan when we go in. We have an identity, and that's I think the most important part of being on a winning team is having that identity and knowing who we are. So on any given day, we know how we're going to play. You know, we don't necessarily change our game plan based on who we're playing. We have a way that we want to play, and we want to dictate the tempo of the game, which I think is really important. That's been instilled since day one this year.
How frustrating has it been to play on baseball fields and a small Vegas field and all that, especially given where you're playing?
It's part of the game, unfortunately, right now for USL, but you know, hopefully you'd like to see stadiums getting a little better in terms of the playing surfaces and stuff like that. But you know, I also think it has gotten better in the last couple of years. So I think as long as we keep going in that direction, you know, hopefully it will keep getting better.
I think the progress has been significant.
Yeah.
Just where it's bad, it's usually pretty bad.
Yeah.
But that's part. We are the USL.
Yeah.
We're not. You know.
Yeah. We're still growing.
Premier League in England or something. Okay, this is an important question.
Here we go.
So which do you think is a bigger accomplishment this year? The fact that you are having an amazing season and you've had some clutch plays, or that you found your long-lost brother, twin brother?
Yeah, the two Joeys. It's I'll tell you what, I don't think we've ever lost a practice game when the two Joeys are on the same team.
Oh, well, there's something.
Yeah.
Seriously, go get a DNA test. Nobody can tell you guys apart.
Honestly, I never looked at them side by side. That's pretty, yeah. We could be brothers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's
we
just
are brothers.
Ridiculous.
There you go.
Yeah. And when we're in the stands, thank God, Joey's here and you're over there.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think earlier in the year, even my mom was getting a little confused. She's like, what are you playing defense for? I'm like, Mom, I'm not.
Now I don't feel so bad.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Oh, that's
exactly.
So funny.
Yeah.
I thought the other night that you were Joey Farrell. Remember, I was telling you about the jersey, right?
Yeah.
And you're like, well, what number's on the jersey?
Yeah.
And I was like, and you were like 21, and it just didn't click in my
exactly.
head. Yeah, it's not 21.
Yeah.
Now I can excuse myself.
At one point, maybe one of us will have to shave the beard. I don't think either of us will, though.
No, I wouldn't.
I don't think so.
It's a good look.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, for both of you.
Yeah, I think we got to keep it.
Keep it.
Yeah.
Keep it. Because Sunday you'll be gray, and then.
Exactly.
It's not quite as. Whoa. Okay, so you know there's a Twitter contest out there. I'm sure you've seen it.
I did see it, yeah.
For a nickname.
I did, yeah.
Have any of the candidates kind of clicked with you at all?
Honestly, there's a lot of creative ones out there. I like them all, and I'm going to leave them up to you guys to decide whatever.
No, you're supposed to say Clutchistri. That's mine.
Clutchistri is good. I like that. It's got a ring to it.
It's got
a
ring to it.
There was Joey Cash made me laugh. That was a good one. That was a solid one. Yeah.
You have become Mr. Clutch.
Okay.
And Michael Vanderplas wanted me to say this to you. He said, how does it feel to be the king of clutch?
I mean, it's fun, yeah. I mean, it's a big title, but I like it, yeah.
It's a huge title and well-earned. We're going to talk about the clutch stuff in a second. He also said that he wanted to sincerely thank you for draping the AZ flag over your shoulders for the interview.
Of course, yeah, absolutely.
Everybody loved that.
Yeah.
That was a good
perfect,
move.
Yeah.
Very good move.
I got it back at the apartment now.
Oh, do you?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Good stuff. So let's talk a little bit about clutch, because the first time came around in the New Mexico game, we were down 2-0, right? Asante comes up, scores in the second half. Junior comes up, now we're tied with them. The streak, right, where everybody's thinking about the streak. We hit the 80th minute, you know, 81st, 82nd, 83rd minute. Look who comes through, Mr. Clutch.
There you go.
What was going through your mind when that ball went into the back of your net, or the net?
Yeah, I think, you know, at that point, it's just kind of it was kind of a knock-around play, like off a corner kick. It got played back in, and then it's just kind of instincts to kind of anticipate where the ball might land.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, you just want to make good contact and keep it on target. You know, obviously that one, there's a lot of traffic in front of me, so you got to hit it off the ground, try to get it over guys. But
it was so congested.
Yeah,
all
on
New Mexico.
It was packed in there, yeah.
Well, everybody's sitting back, just trying to keep us from squatting, right? Do you just kind of blank out in your mind after you score the point and you celebrate?
Yeah, I couldn't tell you what was after that. It's just kind of lights out and your body just takes over. And, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I don't remember what your celebration was on that.
No? The LA game?
Yeah.
Yeah, that, I think it was just a terrible like slide, knee half slide. And then,
okay. Well, at least you can knee slide.
Yeah, I guess, yeah.
You need wet grass. That's
imperative.
Exactly.
It's crucial, yeah.
I tried it once. Back in 1822, did not turn out well. And that was when it was brand new. I mean, this is literally the late 70s.
Yeah.
It was still a new thing.
Exactly, yeah.
And I still remember to the day that, I mean, it was bad.
Yeah.
So let's go to New Mexico. I think New Mexico is our new nemesis. I thought it was going to be Orange County, but they're just not stepping up. Las Vegas is a joke. They'll never be our nemesis. New Mexico has all the right things. They are a thorn in our side. I love to make fun of their fans and their supporter group. We have a whole segment before your interview mocking them. It's just fun to hate them, and it's all good.
Exactly,
all good fun.
Exactly. It's part of the rivalry.
Yep. But when we're in the game and I'm watching them sit back the way they did, and then they score in the first 4 minutes, I became very angry, a little elf. What was going through the team's mind for the rest of that first half? Because you guys were pretty flat. I mean, the play just wasn't there. What was happening with the team?
Yeah, I mean, it was a tough environment for sure. Obviously, it was a loud stadium. And, you know, I think after that first goal went in, there wasn't the immediate response that we usually have.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I think we had a good amount of possession. And we, you know, were kind of wearing them down. And then, you know, they were tough to break down, which made it more difficult, obviously. But I think, you know, in the second half, we definitely stepped it up. And especially after the second goal went in, we, you know, you saw like a visual response from everybody.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, when that happens, and, you know, it's either after the first goal or second goal, whenever it happens, you know, teams should get scared. Because when we have that look in our eye and we, you know, we get a goal that maybe we shouldn't or something like that, and then we come out firing, it's pretty scary.
There's just something that clicks with the team, and it's very obvious when it clicks. In this case, it just clicked later than it normally does.
Yeah.
When you are coming down on your first goal, and you're coming down on the side of the goal, I mean, the angle is almost impossible to hit. We were talking about this before the interview. Take us through a little bit what was going through the head, what you were trying to do.
Yeah, so the ball was, I had to reach for it a little bit, which meant that I couldn't really cut it back. So I was just trying to hit it at the near post, and then the keeper ended up cheating for the cross, so it kind of went over him, which was, you know, perfect.
Yeah, just slid right behind
him. Exactly,
We had a fan, and his name is Beach428, I think. Sorry, I want to make sure I get his name right, because I promise people that I'll bring him up. Yeah, Beach48, and his question was it a pass or was it a shot on target or on goal?
I don't know. That's a good question. No, it was so it was aiming for the near post, and you know, it wasn't necessarily a cross or a shot, but it was just going for that area, and because he cheated, it went in.
You should just go with it was a shot.
Yeah.
It was a shot. I meant to do that.
Of course, yeah. Exactly. That's Zach Lubin.
No. You know, Zach will take this out on me. He's bigger than me.
Yeah.
Doggone it.
He's bigger than everybody.
Devin Kerr has a question. I'm going to fade back for a little bit because I do want to talk about fitness towards the end of the season. Devin Kerr wanted to ask, you know Devin, right? One of the announcers.
Yeah.
He goes, any changes or issues to your body in terms of climatization coming to Arizona? Adjusting to the temperature, how your body reacts to the heat?
Yeah, I wasn't used to it being this cold all the time. No, obviously at the beginning of summer when it was, you know, the first like 3-4 weeks of it being like 110, 115 every day, that was a bit of an adjustment period because I've never had anything like that. But, you know, after that, after 3-4 weeks, you get used to it and it's just, you know, part of the job.
Do the muscles just adjust to it?
I think so, yeah. There's definitely like a feeling out process where you have to get used to it. But, at a certain point, it becomes an advantage to us because we're used to playing in this weather and teams aren't.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of like the opposite of cold. I mean,
yeah,
with cold.
Exactly.
I think cold's a little harder to adjust to. Mm-hmm. It always slows me down.
Yeah.
But interesting. I do have a question. This is from my daughter, who must have gotten in my word processor. What are you doing Friday night? Megan, come on. You know, skip that. Okay.
Getting ready for the game.
Second goal, New Mexico. Probably the best 30 seconds the USL is going to have all season long.
Crazy, yeah.
What's going through your head when the ball hits the post, not one time, but twice?
It's just, I mean, at that point, you're almost feeling like, come on, like, we got to catch a break, you know? But obviously, you know, we had so much pressure on them, and they were sitting so deep that anytime they cleared the ball out, we'd put it back right back in, and then they cleared out, we'd put it back in. And so they were under constant pressure, and I think, yeah, T was the one who crossed it in, and it was kind of like a diving clearance out, and then luckily it popped right to me.
The guy heads the ball, and I mean, he just hands it over to you.
Yeah.
The funny thing is that you had so much space, you had a second to tee it up.
Oh, I know, yeah,
right?
It's perfect.
I'm assuming you were just on automatic pilot at that point.
Yeah, oh, yeah. That's one of those that you worked on the training ground for, you know, hundreds of times, where you just get a ball into your feet, touch out, and hit to the far post. But yeah, at that point, it's just kind of instinct taking over.
Do you watch yourself on tape, taking the shot?
I've seen it again, yeah. It was fun to watch, but not too much.
It's
focus
like,
on the next one.
He's got it on repeat on his
It's in the apartment, just always on the TV. No, not too much. You gotta, you know, it's fun to enjoy, but then you gotta move on to the next
you
one.
You got more business to take
exactly,
care of. Yeah.
Exactly, yeah.
But I do think officially, I put this on my Twitter account, I think this is one of the plays, kind of like the what's in the water thing with Drogba,
yeah,
that goes down in PRFC history.
Yeah.
It was amazing. I mean, the shot is just so blatantly on target, and watching the goalie's reaction, it just makes my heart.
Goalies and the players on the field is pretty fun to watch.
Yeah, they're talking about us flopping, and they look like Saving Private Ryan out there.
Great movie, by the way.
Yeah, it was. Let's see. Okay. I had another comment. This is not really a question, from Laura C. Richards. Thanks, Laura. She says, "My boy." I can't help the quality.
Oh,
that's it.
Yeah, well, Laura. Thank you, Laura. Appreciate it.
She likes you. Mark Richards might be related. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Says, who the hell is... No, he says... Do you prefer... And I love this question. Do you prefer being called Joe, Joey, or Nick?
I mean, Nick was a new one to me, man. I've never, ever heard Nick before. I've been called a lot of things on the field, but never been called Nick. So I guess, you know, actually, I'm not crazy about Nick. It's kind of weird.
Yeah,
yeah,
it's very random.
Call me off guard, yeah.
Yep.
Either Joey or, you know, Vito's another one that the guys love.
We poke fun at the announcers. I got to say that the guys were pretty fair and balanced.
Mm-hmm.
So I do give them props.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not always that way, but the whole Nick thing.
Yeah,
even my girlfriend was like, that's Joey.
All my Deerfield guys were, you know, hitting me up in our group meeting, you know. Having a good time with that one.
Yeah, and it's not even your fault. You're just I'm just playing my game.
Yeah, exactly. What are you going to do?
Oh, that's funny. So definitely not Nick. Okay, we got that much. Another big debate topic is regular season champions versus USL Cup. Do you have a preference? Do you think one is more important than the other? Or do you just want it all and it's all the same?
Yeah, I'd say they're both nice when you have both. They go well together.
There you go. I ripped on regular season last year, and I've always been more of a cup guy, but actually I've changed my mind. Talking to people last year, because I was ripping on FC Cincinnati, because they're only good to hate. So I've come around on the regular season thing, and I was very upset I couldn't go to New Mexico. Very, very angry and bitter over that still. When you go through the playoffs, I mean, it's a one-round you lose and you're out type of thing. The intensity has just got to triple, quadruple. When you're walking on the pitch with the kids, does it become a little bit more of a nervous experience for you? Getting those nerves.
I wouldn't really say nervous. I think it's more an excitement that you feel, especially, you know, every game we play here is an insane environment. So in the playoffs, it's going to be, you know, multiplied. So we're going to be really excited. Obviously, there's a little bit of nerves that goes with it, but that's what makes it fun, and you know, I'd say it's more excitement than anything.
Okay, great. T2's coming up this weekend. I was talking to Jose a little bit before the interview. Looks like that the Portland Timbers have a game on Sunday, so we probably won't see a lot of players coming down. How's the team feeling about going up there and playing against T2?
Yeah, Timbers are a good side. They've done well this year, even with a lot of squad rotation, a lot, not necessarily a consistent starting 11, because obviously they have guys coming down and stuff like that, but they play well. They're organized. They have some athletic players who are good on the break, and you know, it's going to be a tough test, but I think we're definitely up for it. We're ready to go.
Do you feel like there's a little bit more intensity given what happened in New Mexico? It's like, you know, we just want to go out there and knock somebody off the pitch.
Yeah, no, I mean, we definitely, you know, we're trying to get that rhythm going and trying to, you know, go into playoffs flying, so I think it's going to be a good one.
Perfect. I'm looking forward to the game. Yeah. I want to see what happens. Just the last couple of questions and we're done. Who do you support? What clubs do you support out there?
Arsenal.
Oh!
Arsenal fan, baby. There we go.
They're everywhere.
There we go. It's tough. It's not easy. It's not easy, but somebody's got to do it.
Somebody's got to do
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
Oh, that's so funny.
Yeah.
I meant to ask this and I didn't. Fatigue management. End of season always gets difficult for footy players. I mean, any sport, really.
Yeah.
What do you do? Anything different in order to manage fatigue, to get your body recuperated from a match?
I think, you know, for the most part, I kind of have the same, you know, I'll do the same recovery techniques, you know, I still have stuff like that. And I think if you're consistent with that throughout the year, you don't really have to change too much. Obviously, sometimes your legs are a little heavier, but I think, you know, I think we're all in pretty good health. So I think we're ready to go.
It's been incredible how good a shape we've been in fitness-wise when we've had three games in a week.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we see some guys with heavy legs, to be expected, but yeah. Overall, the fitness of the team has been fabulous.
Yeah.
So I know you're focused on the season, but any idea what's up next for you in postseason? Do you go home to Chicago to be with family?
Yeah, so I'll probably go home to Chicago. I definitely want to travel around a little bit this offseason, maybe see a couple of friends who are in, you know, Boston, San Francisco, a couple of places. But yeah, I think I'll be home for the most part, which would be nice. Winter in Chicago, can't beat it. Just the life going from perfect weather here to, you know, freezing your ass off in Chicago.
You remember when the Rams played in the Super Bowl, it was with who was the quarterback that was for the Cardinals for a while?
Kurt Warner. Yeah, Warner.
And Chicago got snowed in.
Yeah.
I was stuck in Chicago.
Really?
Yeah, for that. Yeah.
I think so. The day after I moved out here, it was -55 in Chicago, wind chill. The day after I moved out here.
That's just.
And I was just like, good timing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Perfect timing to come out. Yeah.
Good stuff.
Yeah.
Anybody you want to do a shout out to before we wrap things up? Friends, family.
Well, the Deerfield guys. Here we go. Deerfield guys represent. Calling me Nick all the time now, so we'll give them a shout.
I had a couple of Omar Bravo jokes lined up, but yeah. I'm going to forego them.
Were they good?
I'll give you
yeah,
one
yeah,
of them.
Say, yeah.
How did Bravo get his first name?
I don't know.
Because every time he almost scored a goal, the fans screamed, "Oh my God, it almost went in." Thank you.
That's brilliant.
Yeah,
brilliant.
I know.
Brilliant stuff.
We get bored. Listen, appreciate you coming on here.
Absolutely, yeah.
Mr. Clutch, you
appreciate
know,
it, yeah.
It has been fantastic. Hopefully we're going to see you get the cup at the end of the season.
Oh, yeah.
We see you back next year. We wish you all the best.
Appreciate it.
And go get T2 this week.
Yeah, there we go. Thanks for having me.
Thank you, Joe.
Thanks.
Wow, what a great interview. You're like the best interviewer in the whole world, Kevin.
I am the Barbara Walters of soccer interviews, am I not?
I don't think our audience knows who Barbara Walters is.
I'm very old. That is true. It was all Joey. Joey, you are Mr. Clutch. Thank you so much for the interview. It was a joy to talk to you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Dan, any words of wisdom before we leave?
You're asking the wrong person for wisdom.
Yeah, that's true. So we're going to leave it at this. We are the PRFC Fan Show, a fan show by fans for fans, and I'm Kevin.
I'm still Dan.
We'll see you next time. Man. Don't take the yellow pills with the green pills, Dan.
I take all the pills. Give me the pills, man.
Give me, mix it with this. This is good stuff.
Ashwan pills.
Now you gotta make jokes.
I wonder what would happen if we filmed this show sober.
Terrible, terrible things.
You know, I don't know what it would be like to be part of 11th place New Mexico United. What do you think, Dan?
Well, being at 11th place New Mexico United, I think you've got 13,000 people in the audience there. I'm not even going to call them fans.
Let's talk freighter, Dan. Freighter thoughts.
I think you're talking about Kevon Trader.
Ah, yeah. No, not at all. Especially since stickers have been used since fucking stickers have been invented.
Since the advent of adhesive.
Punching up.
We're punching up. You got to punch level or up. You can't punch down. That's why I'm having such a hard time making fun of these 11th place New Mexico United fans.
You know, I feel like 11th place New Mexico United rolls off the tongue.
It really does. 11th place New Mexico United. 11th place. It does not roll off the tongue, people. It doesn't roll off anybody's
Actually,
tongue.
Actually, after as much as he's had to drink, it does not roll off the tongue.
It's like my fifth this is like my fifth Pinot Grigio, y'all. Hold on.
Stop exposing your bald spot.
Chops busted, my fellow adult. Chops busted.
Diet. It makes it better.
I got me a Zach Lubin training top. You know how I can tell it's a Zach Lubin training top?
Oh.
Well, it doesn't have any numbers on it, but it still smells like him.
Why is Omar Bravo called Omar Bravo?
Why is that?
Because when he broke into a trot, we'd all go, Bravo!
All right, we're going to cut that out.
I tried.